Harmony Turner throws it up top to Mullaney, who fires one far side to the senior Maggie McCarthy. The co-captain bounces it into Rodriguez, who dribbles centrally, skips it out near corner three, rattles around in, is good for Lola Mullaney. It's 12-7 UMass.
That's why Harvard can get back into game so quickly. It's because of Lola Mullaney.
Sam Breen to the near wing, Destiny Phylloxi. Phylloxi jab steps now, dribbles right. Good defense by Forbes. Phylloxi fires one far corner. Mayo into the lane, drops it off. Gallicolone easy two. Great ball movement.
And that's why McKenna White was so successful in their last game against Harvard. Harvard is not great in interior defense. Gallicolone wasn't able to hit layups last game. She has so far today.
Rodriguez has it on the left baseline. Great pass to the near wing, Mackenzie Forbes. Forbes driving right on Breen, who closes her off. Forbes left it short. Sam Breen didn't jump for the rebound, but fortunately it got tipped right to Gallicolone. And here come the Minute Women wearing their home whites. Mayo, cross court, Taylor, extra pass. Phylloxi wide open for three. Off the back rim, no good. Long board, and it's grabbed by McCarthy near half court. McCarthy across the center timeline to Turner on the far wing. Turner down low to Rodriguez, who scores the layup. Sydney Taylor was caught ball watching, so it's now 14-9 UMass.
Yeah, I like the extra pass there on that last offensive possession by Sydney Taylor, but that's not really Destiny Phylloxi's shot. She tends to take a little bit to get her shot ready as we get an offensive foul called on UMass.
That was the first missed shot by UMass, that Phylloxi three a moment ago, and now UMass turns it over. It'll be a personal foul on Destiny Phylloxi. The winner of this game between Harvard and UMass will take on the victor between Richmond and Rhode Island. Right now, Rhode Island leads by 9 with 12 minutes remaining. But here at the Mullen Center, Mackenzie Forbes drives baseline for Harvard. She skips it far wing to Elena Rodriguez, who just flies past Gallicolone into the lane. We have a travel, and Harvard turns it over.
That was a little bit of a late call.
The reason it was a travel was Mayo came over to take the charge. So when Rodriguez picked up her dribble to lay it up, she saw Mayo was in the way, so she kind of hopped in the air trying to get around her to attempt to pass. But it required an extra step. Sam Breen got fouled before putting the layup up and in. So it'll be a foul on the floor. And would you look at this, an interesting substitution. Kristen Williams will be the first Minute Women to sub in today. She will replace Bernaya Mayo. McKenna White will also enter for Angelique Gallicolone. Stephanie Kuleja is on the bench. She is dressed for UMass. But that's very peculiar as Phylloxi goes into Taylor. Almost had it poked away. She finds Phylloxi far corner. Number three for UMass. Dribbles centrally. Finds White at the left elbow. Now Taylor left wing. Sydney Taylor. Good defense by Harmony Turner. So Taylor goes up top to Breen. Down low to White. Five to shoot. McKenna's turnaround jumper. Rolls around. No good. Mullaney gets the board. And here come the Crimson. Harmony Turner down the near side right past us. Stops at the right wing. Drops it down low to Rodriguez, who skips it far side. Mackenzie Forbes' triple is good. And Harvard has trimmed it to a one-possession game. It's 14-12 Massachusetts.
Kristen Williams couldn't quite contest that shot from the much taller Mackenzie Forbes.
Now Breen going baseline. And she fires a pass to Phylloxi. Another three by Destiny. It's good.
That's the shot we like from Destiny, when she can really get into her legs on the shot.
So UMass leads by 5 with 4 minutes to go in the first quarter. Mackenzie Forbes, a response three, hits it as well. Forbes continuing to score Massachusetts, as she's done throughout her career.
8 points already.
So McKenna White has a right baseline turnaround jumper. That's too strong. And Turner gets the rebound, keeping her toes inbound on the baseline. Harvard a chance to tie here with 3:40 to go in the first, or take the lead. Rodriguez fakes the three, skips it out now. Lola Mullaney, three-pointer on the way, three-pointer through the net. Harvard's got their first lead of the day. It's 18-17 Crimson.
Elena Rodriguez slowly, nimbly walking back.
Kristen Williams for three, and she hit it. And now we will have an injury substitution as Elena Rodriguez will come out. Big grimace on her face as she hobbles off uncomfortably.
Taking a strike on the first pitch at the bottom of the first is Gianna Wamling against the right-handed hurler Taylor Hawkman. Getting the start for St. Louis, the righty winds and delivers. It's tapped softly to first base and making the play over there is number 5, Cammy Newbanks, for out number 1. For Taylor Hawkman, the sophomore pitcher from Frankfort, Illinois.
She's also coming in with a 2-5 record. Both pitchers trying to get back in that win column. 2 complete games on season for her.
Hawkman hasn't been quite as successful this year as she was last year. She's got an ERA sitting just below 6. A whip of 1.8. The issue for Taylor Hawkman has been the control. 25 walks to 23 strikeouts. That ratio is nowhere close to where you want to be. And she is behind on Whittier. 2 balls and no strikes. You mentioned Chloe Whittier had the very big first game for UMass. She really saw the ball quite well out of Chloe Wendling's hand. And here she slashes one to right base, hit past the dive of Cammy Newbanks. And Chloe Whittier continues to hit. She's got a single, and it's her 3rd hit of the day. UMass has the first base runner here in game 2.
And that's going to bump her most likely over the 360 average mark on the season. She just sees the ball so well, is able to take it the other way. For a nice base hit to start this game off for the Minute Women with 1 down in the bottom of the first.
Whittier doing a good job of using the whole field, and now it'll bring up Sarah Keggy. And Keggy flies the first pitch foul down the right field side. The count is 0-1. On the right-handed batter who wears number 19, Keggy, the junior from Acton, Mass., attended Acton Boxborough Regional High School before coming to UMass. This is her 26th start of the season, and Keggy grounds one to the right side. Moving to her left is Abbott. Her only plays to first, and she will throw out Keggy for the 2nd out of the 1st inning. Now batting, left fielder, number 4, Jules Shields. Now we take a look at the defense for St. Louis. It is the exact same as it was in game 1. Sullivan, Kowalik, and Marietta the outfield left to right. Mallow at 3rd, Ryan at short, Abbott at 2nd, Newbanks at 1st, and Kelsey Etling doing the catching. She may catch 10 to 12 innings here today. And she takes strike 1 on the outside corner.
That's a if it ain't broke, don't fix it lineup.
Yep.
12-1 win. I think the coach decided, I think they're doing a pretty good job. We can keep it pretty similar into the 2nd game.
Head coach Christy Kanoyer for St. Louis has kept a similar starting lineup really for almost all the games this year for St. Louis. I wrote my lineups in my scorebook before we got them today because that's how consistent she has been, and it was exactly correct. The count is 1-1 on Jules Shields, who had a 5 RBI game on Wednesday at Boston College. And here she takes inside. Shields delivered the biggest hit for UMass this season. A 3-run go-ahead home run with the Minute Women down to their final 2 outs at Chestnut Hill on Wednesday. It's part of a career day for number 4 in maroon and white. And here she slashes it to center field, base hit. Whittier rounding 3rd. She'll get the stop sign. And the throw is cut off by Newbanks. And Jules Shields with a single. And the Minute Women have runners on the corners.
You really need the bats to just stay hot. St. Louis can put up runs like we saw in that first game. And a problem with the Minute Women is they've had a lot of good individual performances, but the team has not been able to really come together in individual games to get those winning runs like they did against Boston College. And you really hope they can put together those complete games.
Well, UMass averages less than 3 runs a game, and that comes from not having a team approach. Bantoja slaps it to 3rd. Mallow throws to 1st, and that will retire to the side. The Minute Women get 2 hits, but they cannot score. So at the end of 1 inning, St. Louis and UMass scoreless here from Sortino Field.
You already have a couple huge milestones. You're the program's all-time leader in assists and in games played. You're also approaching the all-time record in minutes played for UMass. When you were a young kid, did you ever imagine that you'd be able to be one of the best a college has ever seen?
No. In all honesty, no. I mean, I was one of them kids with an imagination, but I never thought this far, honestly, because it wasn't really believable, just where I'm from. But once I finished my freshman year, it all started to come clear that I was meant to be here, and then I could achieve a lot of stuff. and now I'm stamped in UMass history, and that's really all I could really ask for. And it's been a great 5 years, honestly.
You mentioned that at first it didn't seem like clear to you that it could be a path. Your older sister Selena played basketball at Seton Hall in Siena. Did she help pave the path for you a little bit?
When it came to AAU in high school, I would say yes. Most schools were looking for her. Honestly, I think UMass was looking at her first because people didn't know who I was or if I even existed. Mm-hmm. So when we were younger, AAU reached out to her. She was playing on teams. I saw her traveling a lot. Like, I want to join, and they didn't know who I was. So then my sister told them about me. They came look me out. The same thing for high school. They see my sister playing AAU, and then they found out about me. And same thing in college. They found out about me. She did pave the way, but I feel like we went to two different schools for a reason. I got tired of being Selena's sister instead of being Destiny, and I wanted to build my own name, so that's why I came here, just to build my own name, and now I'm known as Destiny instead of Selena's sister.
You certainly are known as Destiny here. When you look at the UMass program and your 5 years here, what are you most proud of throughout your development, both as a person and a player here?
What I'm most proud of? That's a good question. I'm just proud of how I grew. And on the court, it's just my facilitating. My freshman year, I was more of a scorer, and I took on a different role throughout the years come to become a facilitator, to become a team captain and leader. So I feel like I'm just proud of myself for just growing on the court and understanding that your role can change every year and every game. And I grew into that, and now I feel like I'm just one of the best players to ever play at UMass. And off the court, I just took academics more seriously and understood that you have to become a student first instead of in order to be an athlete. And I feel like Coach Brady makes sure of that, and he had my back throughout every struggle that I have.
When you were a younger player here at UMass, I think at times, correct me if you disagree, but your emotions would like bubble to the surface during games and maybe during practices too. Was there ever a moment where you realized, where you switched into more of a leader mindset?
Yeah, I was young. I actually came to UMass to play basketball and just have fun until I realized that there are people actually who really want to go far with basketball stuff, and I got to help them. And as I grew up, it was like I wanted someone to have me the way I want these freshmen to have someone. So honestly, just trying to give them the right image of what UMass is all about and making sure when I leave that UMass is in good hands, and I feel like I'm doing a great job at that.
You mentioned a little bit last year when you approached a couple big milestones that you sometimes think of head coach Torrey Verde as your father, as a father figure. Mm-hmm. Can you speak to what he means to you?
Oh, he means a lot to me. We have that friendship, that bond that I don't think a lot of players have with their own coaches. Mm-hmm. And I just see him as a father figure. I didn't grow up with a father, so like when I came here, he was teaching me how to ride a bicycle all over again, you know? He taught me the way of life. He taught me how to grow up, and he made sure that I grew up. And he taught me that it's okay to have emotions. You just gotta understand, like, you can't act on them every single time. And he had my back every single step of the way, regardless if I was wrong. He told me in private, but he backed me up in public. So I feel like that took a long way. And I feel like me and him are just locked in. We both signed a contract, so now he's in my life forever. He can't leave.